Frances first got in touch with us. In fact, she's nothing if not persistent. I think he came in on several routes. Eventually, we made it. The guy from the Olympics put you in touch with us. Mm-hmm. I think we picked you up on Twitter, and someone else, it might have been Marcus, might have even got a direct email. And she's looking out for a relative called Vera Cox, and we've heard of Vera Cox, which is played for England in the 1910s. But in fact, we had no idea what an amazing story. And over the months that we've been collaborating, we found out some fantastic stuff today. And not only is it that evidence in the past, but today, Frances has been here all day, and we've almost doubled the information that she's got in her fingertips from just going through the archives that we've got. So I think probably the best thing is to hand over to Frances to talk to this fantastic story. Hopefully we'll have time for questions at the end.
Yes.
And then if anyone would like to join us, we're going out for a light talk to eat just around the corner. So you're very welcome to join us for that. Okay, over to you, Frances.
Wonderful. That's lovely to see everyone here.
Thank you.
I'll start off with a limerick. There was a young lady of Kent whose shoulders were very much bent. When they said, "Oh my dear," she replied with a sneer, "Oh rot, I play hockey for Kent." So that limerick was written by Bernard. This family of siblings love writing poems, and they wrote loads of poems about Vera because they were very proud of her. So, and also there's other things that mention girls getting bent shoulders for hockey, and it wasn't the dumb thing, because obviously ladies needed to have good deportment. So in fact they're saying she had bent shoulders. So that's a photo of her there. A friend of mine in Canada colorized some photos. She says, "Oh, I'm no professional, they're not very good." And I'm like, "Oh, that's amazing." So these were black and white photos that Katie found. And so that's a colorized photo. That's her age 21, when she's just started playing hockey in Kent. She learned hockey at, that's the school, Coed Bell. Then she played for Kent, she played for Atalanta, which was her local team, she played for East, then she played for England, then she was captain. Then she was made MBE and OBE, both for work with the Women's Land Army. And then she was on board for everything, and involved in everything, whether it was umpiring or selector in both hockey, and then she moved over to cricket, so she had a knee injury, and then moved over to cricket, and then was basically in cricket and hockey until like she was 60. And then eventually retired. Okay, so this is the family that I first started off. So I'm related to Edmund, or I'm related to all of them. This is Dr. Cox and his wife, Mrs. Cox. So they're my second great grandparents, and Edmund is my first great grandfather. So I've got it written down here. I first heard about Vera from my Auntie Judy. For years, she said, "You really should try and visit the Bodleian Library. There are a lot of our family letters in there." I lived in Hong Kong and it took me a few years to get there. I remember my granddad writing for the family budget when I was a child. Edmund's my great-grandfather and Vera is my great-grand-aunt, the sister of my great-grandfather. So there's 10 children. This is Vera in the middle, the short one. She's 11, she's the youngest. We think that's about 1895. And they're a wealthy lot. Father is Anglican clergy, and this is Northampton Holdenby, which is right next door to Althorp Estate, where the Spencers live. And that parish was in the gift of Gladstone, the Prime Minister. So the fact that Dr. Cox was obviously doing the right political stuff, that he got given this parish by Gladstone, because it was a very wealthy parish, which meant Dr. Cox didn't have to do any work, that there was loads of money, and there were only about 20 parishioners. So he spent all his time writing books and writing letters and didn't do any church work at all. That's my take on it. So if you know the Prime Minister and you get the wealthy parish, you don't have to do it, or maybe you've got a curate that does all the work. Right. So if you're interested, have a listen to the first episode of my podcast. It's called 100 Years of Cox. So I discovered all these letters and just became enchanted with them and started the podcast. By 1906, three of the brothers lived abroad in the colonies and seven of the siblings lived in England. The mother said, "You should start a family budget and write to each other, because I won't always be here to write letters to all of you every week." So Mrs. Cox was writing a letter to every single child every single week, and she's saying, "I'm getting old, you should start writing to each other." So if you don't know what a family, if you don't know what a budget is, the word budget comes from the French, and when the Chancellor opens the budget, he's opening the leather satchel to then get the financial documents out. So originally the budget meant the bag the documents were in, not the financial documents. So there was once a newspaper called the Pall Mall Budget in London. So the word budget means news and letters. And in the 1800s, it was very common for families to write a budget, which meant that one person writes a letter, you post it onto the second person, you then comment on the first letter, post it onto person three, comment on all of those, post it onto person four, comment on all of those. So you only have to write one letter that goes around everybody, rather than have to write to individual people, and you get all the family news that way. So that's what the family budget is. This is the first envelope. So you can see 1906, September to October, budget series one, number one, and those were the six siblings who wrote the first one. And all of this is in the Bodleian Library where I found it. So it started in 1906. The letters continued non-stop as each budget circled the globe. As the older siblings died, their children were invited to join. Eventually the letters were being written by the cousins, the children of the 10 siblings, including Leslie, who was my granddad, and Vera, who was the last of the 10 siblings to be alive. She died in 1973, and then you just got the cousins, and the cousins kept it going until the 1980s. The last two cousins were both Oxford professors, one of whom was a Sir Christopher Machell Cox, worked for the Secretary of State, and was involved in setting up a school or a university in every single colony. So he travelled the world to all the former British colonies, setting up schools and universities, and wasn't at home at all. He said to the Bodleian, hey, I've got this amazing resource with all these letters from 1906 all the way through to the 1980s, are you interested? And thankfully the Bodleian said yes. So you've got these letters that cover things like both World Wars, Scouts, Winston Churchill being a liar, suffragettes, votes for women, and even things like them arguing about the correct use of the exclamation mark. You know, these siblings, they argued about everything. It was quite fascinating. To say I was enchanted by these letters is an understatement. Some of them wrote Dear Family, some wrote Dear Budget. Aldwin, who's the African missionary, coined the phrase Dear Budgeteers. And this is the envelope from the very first one. Right, before I get on to hockey, I'll just give you a bit of background about the family. This is a group of young wealthy adults going slumming. So it's like, what would it be like to go on holiday without going to a hotel and having a maid to look after you? So three of them are the children of the Bishop of Woolwich, who was near Sydenham, and they were the cousins of the Machell Coxes. So there's three of them here. This is Emily and Jack at the back there, and I think Willie's taking a photo. This is Joyce Hatton, who's one of the hockey players, Vera's friend, that's Vera. And then you've got Bernard, and you've got Cuthbert, and you've got Arthur. So the Machell Cox siblings are on holiday on the Isle of Wight with Dr. Cox, who's being a normal grump and shouting at the housemaid because she keeps trying to clean his study. He was a grumpy Edwardian man, although they tolerated him very well. So they're on holiday in the Isle of Wight. They get on their bicycles, they go down to the ferry, they get the steamer across to Lymington, they then cycle 5 miles to a little village called Milford on Sea, which is in Hampshire, where they've met their cousins who've come from Sydenham in a gypsy caravan. They've borrowed the horse from the grocer at Sydenham. This horse has never pulled a gypsy caravan before and is most confused. And they'll have arranged all that by letter, because phones didn't exist. So if you can imagine, how on earth you link up with your cousins by letter? And they have food in a field, and they cook them food, and they say, oh, it's very nice. We had their eggs and bacon, and then they had blackberry and apples stewed, and the cousins cooked it for them. And they said, it's lovely now, but goodness knows what they do when it rains. So this is 1910, and they're slumming it. There's another one here. This is Vera. These are the short hockey skirts that they talk about. So a short hockey skirt meant that it was, 3 inches higher up than from your ankle. And that they wear it for bicycling because Dr. Cox didn't approve of the knee-length bloomers that the other people weren't bicycling in. So that's Vera on the right, that's her sister Alice in the middle, you've got Bernard on the left, Dr. Cox is the one going in the middle, and that's Cuthbert, so some of the siblings, and that's 1913. They did loads and loads of bicycling. There's Vera in the middle in her Sunday best, they're in Studland on holiday, down in Dorset. Dr. Cox, the father, is on the right, and that's his sister next to him. In the letters they talk about, oh, doesn't Dad look handsome in his spotted dress? Because that's his sister, but does look very manly, doesn't she? So one of his sisters is on the left, the one in the spotted dress is Dr. Cox's sister, two unmarried sisters, and that's Dr. Cox on the right. Mother is the one in the middle, and then at the back you've got Avis and Cuthbert, and at the front you've got Bernard and Vera and Neville in 1907. And wow, look at those outfits. Right, 1905. So this was one of the photos that, that my friend in Canada colourised for me, where I said, you know, do you fancy putting some colour on some photos, because I'm talking to the Hockey Museum, and she's like, yeah, yeah, I'll have a go. So I've never met Gloria. She's in Canada, and we've been emailing, and I sent her these, and she's, yeah, I'll put some colour in them. She says, they're not very good. I'm like, wow, they're absolutely awesome. So this is Vera here. She's age 21, and this is her playing for Kent. And we know that the costumes were navy. And the other thing we know is that they had brown boots and brown stockings. Gloria said sometimes the programme won't do what you want and she couldn't make it go brown. So they're black boots, but Addis, who was Vera's sister, said they wear brown boots and brown stockings so you can't see the mud much. Mm-hmm. And then the navy costumes. And we know lots of who all those people are. 1905. Right, in 1906, when the letters start, Vera is 22, she's looking after her ageing parents, she's playing tennis at the Crystal Palace Tournament and the Forest Hill Tennis Club, both of which she won everything. She was also playing hockey for her local team, which was Atalanta, and we just worked out that that local ground was Bickley, so it was all in that south area near Croydon and Chislehurst and Bromley and Sydenham and Forest Hill, and that was the area. So that was where Atalanta was based. Then she played hockey for Kent. She could run faster than all her brothers. She would outcycle them too if it weren't for the long skirts she had to wear. So basically all her brothers accepted that Vera was just better than them. Even though she had to wear these long skirts, she sounds like she was very competitive. In the 1930s, Vera and a friend were driving past the Oval. They realised the Aussie men's team was playing. She stood up in the car while her friend was driving and identified the bowler from his unmistakable bowling style even at a distance. She had a vast knowledge of hockey and cricket. She just knew everything about it. So standing up in one of these old cars, seeing a guy throwing a ball and saying, oh yeah, that's what's his name from Australia, I can tell because the way he swings his arm, it's that, it's him. Right, I will read you some snippets about hockey from the letters because the siblings wrote so much about her. Just to help you keep up with the names, there are 10 siblings. There are 5 from the older family, Edmund, who's my relative, Edmund, Enid, Arthur, Neville, and Wilfred. Then there was a gap of 4 years, don't know what happened, we think maybe Dr. Cox was abroad. Then there's the younger family, Bernard, Aldwyn, Cuthbert, Avis, and Vera. So Vera's the youngest, born in 1884. The oldest was born in 1868. So it's quite a gap between them. Right, I'll read you some of these. So this is October. This is 1906. My little white horse Kent badge does not constitute the whole of my piece of clothing. I have a flannel blouse with a detachable collar, a magnificent brown coat and skirt, and a superb hockey outfit. Hockey begins next week, and this year I've quite made up my mind to play hockey for Europe, if not for the world. Arthur, her brother, I hope the budget baby will tell her hockey deeds and send me Ladies Field, which I will return to her. Vera replied, Atalanta played Beckenham yesterday, we won 6-3. Arthur, there won't be anything in the ladies' field until the countermatches start. If there are any good photographs, I'll let you have them if you promise to return them. Bernard, our gentle and pleasant Veronica is cock-a-hoop today. Kent ladies have beaten Middlesex ladies, 10-1. The budget baby distinguished herself by choosing 4. Goals, I mean, not Middlesex ladies. Oh, such a funny one. He actually wrote that. Cuthbert wrote, oh, gentle and pleasant Veronica, beware of ambition. You won't get a vote, even if you play for England. So that was 1907. He wasn't actually being rude about it. He was just saying, hey, the men haven't got the vote yet. Cuthbert didn't get the vote. He was a teacher at Berkhamsted School, which is one of the private schools on the outskirts of London in the north. And he was there for 7 years as a teacher who had a good wage before he got a vote because he kept moving house. So before the First World War, the only men who could vote, I think you had to either employ people or own a house. Or there was obviously some rule that if you were well employed and you stayed in the same house, but because his landladies kept moving or getting sick or dying or retiring, he had to keep moving rooms, and he says, I'm never going to get a vote. So he's basically saying to his sister, if I can't have a vote, you're not going to get one until I get a vote. And they were quite right that obviously when all men got votes, that's then when women start getting the votes. Vera, just to let you know what an important person I am, I'll give you an extract from Ladies Field. Though unfortunately there have been no photographs. We expect to see Kent do great things, their right wing is very strong. Miss Cox, who occupies the inside berth, has come on out of all recognition. She played a quick, dashing, energetic game. Fancy that, they're talking about little me. So Kent, so Ladies Field is one of the magazines. There's also another one called Hockey. There's another one called Hockey Field. There's another one called Black and White. There were lots of these magazines writing about all the sport of the day. Neville is one of the brothers who's in South Africa. I generally hear of Vera's hockey doings from Mrs. Jim, who takes the Ladies Field and keeps me up to date with things. But so far, I've seen no photographs. This is in Pretoria in South Africa. Avis, who's sibling number 9. I went to watch Vera play for East versus North today. I do like their hockey costumes. They wear brown stockings and brown boots, so one really does not even see the mud. The spectators were enthusiastic and cheered very loudly. Vera played very well, though she got no goals. Vera took tea at the man who writes the reports for Ladies Field, so she ought to be honourably mentioned in the next edition. Enid, she's the eldest sibling. Many congratulations, Vera, on the great hockey victory of East over South. It was actually reported in the Times, a most unusual thing for ladies' hockey at the time. Right, so 1909 we're up to. This is Richmond. In some other photos, you can see the pagoda. So the pagoda of Kew Gardens is just off the shop here. We're trying to work out where the grandstand was. We don't think the grandstand is there now, but this is where a lot of the matches happened. The field is still there. It's called Old Deer Park, but the grandstand isn't there anymore. Right, Vera's first England match. So she plays for Atalanta, then she plays for Kent, and then she plays for East, and then she gets a place in the England team in 1908. But I don't have the 1908 photo, so that's that one up there. Vera's first England match was in Dublin in March 1908. A week later, England ladies played Scotland ladies at Old Deer Park in front of a crowd of over 5,000, and Vera scored a hat-trick. This is the ground, that would be the grandstand, where Bernard describes the family sitting. So in March 1908, Bernard wrote, "I arrived at Richmond Station at 2:20 on Wednesday, March the 18th. I had no difficulty in finding my way to the ground, as the street was swarming with long-coated, motor-capped ladies of all sizes, all walking and a good many running in one direction. Arriving at the ground, my eye was immediately caught by the scarlet skirts of old England. An enthusiastic schoolgirl exclaimed breathlessly, 'Oh, don't they look lovely?' I found mother and father already in their seats in the middle of the second row of the grandstand," that will be in there, "behind the seats reserved for the council. Two ladies were in Cuthbert's seats and they refused to move, though Cuthbert had his tickets and the ladies couldn't produce theirs. Not being suffragettes, we didn't like to chuck them out." About 10 minutes after the advertised time, three stalwart Highlanders bagpiped the Scottish team onto the field. The English team started badly. However, they soon warmed up and they won eventually, as you know, by 5-1. The pace of the English forwards was rather astonishing. Vera, Miss Bryant and Miss Everett striking me as being especially fast. Miss Bryant was brilliant and very pretty to watch, though Vera says she plays in the gallery. The English goalkeeper was very feeble and it was lucky she had so little to do. I think that was Miss Johnson. So for some reason, Vera thinks that she wasn't very good. At half-time, Cuthbert and I walked onto the field to talk to Vera, and Father presently arrived and conducted her to the stand to show her off, and she took it very nicely. When the match was over, we struggled for tea in a marquee. They charged us 9p. It was very difficult to get any, and rather second rate when we did. Vera and the two teams went to dinner at the Trocadero, and then they went to see The White Man at the theatre, while Cuthbert and I went to see The Admirable Crichton at another theatre. I hadn't seen it before, and it was splendid. I had to meet Vera after the theatre. Unfortunately, her play was over early, and my play was over late. So I found Vera ensconced by the fire in the vestibule of the Lyric Theatre, with a commissionaire on guard at the door. He'd kept it open specially, so of course he had to be tipped. The next day, the papers were ransacked for accounts of the match. The Telegraph was the worst. The Daily Mirror had snapshots. I enclose one in case you haven't all seen it. So they wrote loads about it. Right, this is one of the newspapers. This is the Mirror. Someone's found this for me. I think they're all drawings rather than photos. Or the top one might be a photo. It's hard to be sure. Cuthbert wrote, so we're still talking about the 1908 March match. Vera is undoubtedly the best on the field at taking and giving passes while going at full speed, but none of them handle their sticks with the cleverness of quite an average man. I suppose, really, it's impossible they should, as all the cleverest work is done right at the feet, and ladies' skirts interfere with that. Still, the game was interesting, and I was proud of Vera. When I got back to Berkhamsted School, I was congratulated right and left by boys and masters on Vera's performance. Some of the papers said 4 goals were hers. Arthur said, I was greatly entertained by Vernon's description of the great hockey match, but the Daily Mirror photo is certainly a fly in the ointment. Alas, my poor sister. So it's obviously not this newspaper, there's obviously another one that was a photo of Vera, and it's very uncomplimentary. April 1908, Vera says, I believe Mother has written to every family member about the hockey match and sent them 2 newspapers each. Vera carries on saying, so Cuthbert had said that women aren't very good at stuff because of long skirts. He says, combination is supposed to be the really strong point of ladies' hockey, and certainly in the international, it was chiefly conspicuous by its absence. Vera says, Cuthbert was disappointed, and I think he's right. Skirts handicap you, but the majority of lady players don't practice it enough, and they certainly ought to be better. I'm very poor myself. Cuthbert should have seen Miss Hawtree. She ought to have been playing, and her stick work is as good as any man. Right, Miss Oliver is captain. So in 1908, Vera says, we're having a Kent dinner at the Trocadero on Monday. Past and present members of the Kent team are presenting Miss Oliver with a silver salver as a wedding present. She was captain of Kent for many years. Then we're going to the theatre after. And there's Miss Oliver in the middle there. So she's getting married. She's been captain of Kent for many years. Silver salver would obviously have been quite a large bowl, very nice, and they're all going out for dinner to give her a wedding present, because often they then left hockey if they were married. Mrs. Wilcox is the only one who appears to carry on once she's married. It wasn't the done thing, really, was it? Right, I have a little hockey badge here. I don't know exactly about it. Vera says in her letter, I'm very proud of a silver brooch I've got as a memento of the English team. Everyone in the 11 has one. And she also says, I've scored 52 goals for Atalanta this season. So I've got this small silver hockey brooch, which has been dated to silver as approximately 1910. At the start of COVID, I was idly Googling images online, and I found this one for sale in a little shop in Oxford. This is while I was in Australia. The owner had started putting pictures online because all the shops were closed because of lockdown, and that's the only reason I saw this photo of a brooch in Oxford and bought it while I was in Australia. So the woman said that this was a collection of antique brooches from an old woman in Oxford. Vera was presented with a small silver brooch. I've no idea if this brooch is similar. It's got the old-fashioned hockey sticks with the curve rather than where you've got the sharp angle, so you know it's very old. If this wasn't the sort of brooch they were presented with, then it's likely this was from county hockey or something else. It's likely to have been that sort of thing. But as all Vera's estate, she's a single woman. All her estate went to her sister's daughter when she died. I've got none of the possessions at all. I've no idea where they are. I've managed to make contact with some of the other branches of the family, but not Vera and Abbas, so I've no idea about her possessions. But nice little badge. Right, they wrote loads and loads of poems. This is Cuthbert. So Vera's first match got them all very excited, and they all wrote poems about her match. Right, I'll read you. This is about 1908, and Cuthbert has said he's written a poem for every single sibling. Wilfred was the sibling who was out in Canada, in the middle of nowhere. It was absolutely backward. Out here, up trapping in the snows, 'tis glorious news I've heard tonight. I've met a man whose cousin knows the sister of your outside right, which is kind of an indication that for the wealthy middle classes, everybody knew everybody if you moved in the same circles. So he's out in Canada, and he's met someone who knows someone in Vera's hockey team. Cuthbert, who is the Berkhamsted teacher, says, in Berkhamsted, I'm pointed out as one of Vera's brothers, the length of skirts I'm asked about by hockey damsels' mothers. So the length of skirts was a very controversial thing. You know, skirts were supposed to go to the ankle. You didn't go showing your ankles, even if you were playing hockey. It was controversial. I've got written down here that the girls wore these short hockey skirts to go cycling. because it was a bit shorter, and Enid, the eldest sister, used to borrow one of Vera's skirts to go walking in the Lake District, and somehow she bumped into people she knew and she was very embarrassed because obviously she was wearing a skirt that was too short and it wasn't acceptable. Arthur wrote another poem about Hoppy. This is another brother. Veronica Cox, she is nimble and fast. In the fiercest of matches, she stays the last. For her place in the team is inside on the right, and to see her combine is a glorious sight. An overlook on that resolute face as she makes for the goal at a wonderful pace. Then the next bit goes on about Dr. Cox being very proud of his daughter. Acquaintances bolt when they sight from afar, exclaiming, "Oh heavens, Miss Cox is papa." The clerk at the bookstall, who cannot retreat, is an easier prey. Him he hastens to greet. "Oh please, Mr. X, will you send up today's lady's field for my daughter, the daughter who plays for England? And this is her photograph, see, with a page to itself as large as can be." Right, this is Berners. Is that Arthur? Right, so now Berners written poem. They've all written poem. Of Veronica and Hoppy. So this is about the telegrams arriving saying you've got a place in the England team. It was about breakfast time on a warm spring day. There came a gallant messenger with telegrams to say, "We all watched your swift brown feet on many a hockey field. Opposing teams before your rush have quailed and faintly squealed. The soul of dash, though never wild, your dribbling and finesse. Oh, will you play for England? There's a very pretty dress." Forthwith she banged with wildest glee the gong upon the wall, and father threw the breakfast things all out into the hall, while mother yelled for marmalade and bolted all the toast, then with swiftly written postcards ran out to catch the post. Then he starts talking about the match, so we're back to the Richmond match where the pipers are piping on the England and Scotland ladies onto the match, onto the field. When onto the field three pipers swung, and crowding behind, some old, some young, the Scotch team marched with unfaltering tread, determined to win or die instead. Then out spake brave Veronica, the English inside right. "To every girl upon this earth, death cometh soon or light. Then how can we win better than trampling on the toes and smashing up the ankles and temples of our foes?" It's very St. Trinians, isn't it? Yeah. Whack them all. Gentle, pleasant young ladies who aren't supposed to do stuff like that. "Throw up the coin, Miss Captain, with all the luck you may, I, with two more to help me, will show you how to play. With all our skill, 1,000 may well be stopped by 3. Now who will stand on either hand and play the game with me?" Then out spake bold Miss Bryant, Lancastrian proud is she. "Lo, I will stand at thy right hand and win the match with thee." Then cried Miss Locke, the long-necked of southern blood was she. "I will abide at thy left side and play my best with thee." "Dear Vera," quoth the captain, "as thou sayest, so let it be. There are 8 others in the team. But pray don't think of me. Come on, you loafing Scotch girls. We cannot wait all day. Lo, here we stand, a gallant band who'll teach you how to play." And they're great poems. Absolutely staggering. So they were so proud of their sister. She's playing hockey for England. It's so exciting. Okay, if you've never heard of Great Comp, this is a very nice country house. It's near Sevenoaks. I think it's pronounced Rotham. Is it Rotham or Rotham?
Rotham.
So it's near Sevenoaks. Mr. and Mrs. Heron Maxwell. It doesn't look that exciting from those pictures, but it's got enormous gardens. It's one of those big gardens that you can go and there's all these roses and it's enormous, beautiful gardens. This is where the Heron Maxwells live. So this is a Vera's photo in 1928. That's what it looks like today. In November 1908, the Kent Hockey Week at Great Comp is mentioned for the first time. Mrs. Heron Maxwell had a big field, and she basically hosted loads and loads of hockey matches on this field, and then she fed them all. I don't know if anyone paid any money. There was a big gymnasium, and they often say that there were 90 for lunch, and then there was 100 for tea, and all these visitors and all these hockey girls were fed food in this big gymnasium. In 1908, Avis, who's the sister of Vera, Avis and Vera at Great Comp playing hockey. Atalanta had sent 2 teams and Avis was playing as well. Avis says, "Atalanta firsts won the tournament easily. Only a few teams could be put up, so the beaten ones had to return home. Atalanta firsts were put up in Mrs. Heron Maxwell's house, so we had a splendid time. She is the president of the Kent Ladies Hockey Association and very hospitable and kind, though she's a great character and her hair is quite short. There's a portrait of her in this week's Ladies Field and also a large group of some of the hockey clubs. Vera and I are in it. At the back of the group is the large gymnasium where we were given lunch and tea. So that could have been one of those photos we looked at today. With the large gymnasium. I haven't got that photo up here. We found some amazing photos today, which of course didn't make sense to have one because we only found them today. That's Mrs. Heron Maxwell. She's never ever said Frances. I didn't know her name was Frances. She was Mrs. Heron Maxwell and then she became Max. And Vera always called her Max. Cool. So it was a surprise when I found out she was called Frances. Avis says there's a very nice account of Mrs. Heron Maxwell in the ladies' field. I had the honour of playing right wing next to her and she coached me up splendidly. So Mrs. Maxwell was clearly still playing in 1908, although there are other accounts saying she was the goalie. But she obviously wasn't the goalie all the time. That's the inside of the house. Amis continues, I think Great Pomp is a perfect house, very old, but all modern comforts. It's in the country and their garden was a lovely one. There are two lady gardeners who wore tunics and blouses and leather belts and had no headgear. In 1909, Vera was worried about the England selections. She says the Kent team was weak, but she got in again. The Richmond game in March 1909 was delayed a week due to snow and ice, but was an exciting match. England won easily again, and there were photos of Vera in Ladies Field and black and white. And I've written down here, neither of which I've yet seen. I have now, we found some today. It was very exciting. Right, that's one of the photos there. That is 1910. Kent is the ones in the dark colour, so they're wearing dark blue, and Surrey is the one in the paler ones. In March 1910, Vera wasn't well. She missed the trip to Ireland, the England-Ireland match. Wilfred wrote in his letter, Vera will be able to play at Richmond on Wednesday. She ran up the hill from the nursing home last night and says she's fit. So I don't know what was wrong with her, but she missed a couple of matches and was in the nursing home. But I think you went to the nursing home if it was like flu, so maybe they thought you got influenza. Vera in 1910, so she's now talking about the ladies, the Richmond match the year after in 1910. I had a great day on Wednesday, the ladies international hockey versus Scotland at Richmond. I very nearly did not play as I did not think I was up to it. However, rather than disappoint members of the family from Liverpool, Ilkeston and Canada, I decided to sacrifice myself and play. We won very easily, 6-0. I decided to foul my own side instead of an opponent and deliberately tripped our centre forward, very neatly, once to my great joy. It was a gorgeous day and there must have been a record crowd for a ladies' match. We had dinner at the Trocadero afterwards, which was very jolly, and then we went to the Arcadians, which I was very bored with. I wish it was not all over. It's almost the end of the hockey season, and one will not see all one's friends until next season. Then, of course, I missed half the fun this year, as I was not able to go to Ireland. However, I was very lucky to get the Richmond match, as I really thought I should not be well enough. Edmund, who's my great-grandfather, he's come to this match, and he says, I must say how much I enjoyed the ladies' international hockey match at Richmond. I especially enjoyed the robust charge of the Scottish centre-forward who absolutely floored the England goalkeeper into a sitting position. Vera was supposed to be off colour, but her play was delightful to watch. Her neat passes at full speed were excellent. She was very pleased with herself because she very trickily managed to upset her own centre-forward, who indeed was far too selfish. Vera's stride is just like a man's. I should think she strides quite twice as fast as any other lady player. Enid, another sibling, wrote, Avis and I heard the list of the English team for 1910 read out here in Liverpool after the territorial match between North and East, although really it was between Lancashire and Kent. Almost all of North was just made from Lancashire and Kent was just brilliant, and so they were in East and hardly anyone got to look in. Enid says it was most exciting. The two Veras both said they were very worried about their own chances. Our Vera had a shotgun cold and was quite unfit to play. In fact, she was so knocked up afterwards that she had to miss the Irish match. By 1910, Vera was coaching other teams, and she says, I'm filled with apprehension. Picture me on the first Saturday in October on a public recreation ground, surrounded by endless strange females. And fancy having to start off on a Saturday afternoon on a public recreation ground. I only found out that after I'd agreed to coach them. The letters from the secretary have been most amusing. In her last epistle, she enclosed an elaborate plan of the ground, even going so far as to write grass, in case I might not know that hockey is usually played on grass. Right, audience participation time. Are you still awake? We're going to make you do some work. Has anyone got a pen?
Yes.
You want to get out a pen? Pass these around amongst yourselves, please. Going to give you something to do. Right, Naomi. If you're upstairs with me today, then no giving away the answers to other people because you know about this already. Bernard, who was one of the siblings, wrote a poem in 1910 and he called it Kent's Eleven at Play. And he wrote this beautiful poem where he mentions every single player and all their positions. So I thought you could have a go and work out what position they all go in. So at the bottom there, you've got a list of all the Christian names, and then you've got a list of all the surnames, and then you've got all the positions. So at the top of the sheet, obviously, that's the goalie, going round to the bottom, which is all the forwards. And I see I put in Mrs. Wilcox and Vera's name, because there actually are two Vera's. Mrs. Wilcox was the only one in the team who was married, and Verna was ever so polite and didn't write down her first name, and we only just found it out today, whereas everyone else is Miss. So have a go, put some first names to some surnames, and see if you can work out whether they are forward, or a back, or an inner, and then I'll give you all the answers. Doesn't matter if you don't get it wrong, there's no marks, and we'll go through it in a minute, and so that you can then work it out. This pick is the 1912 Kent team, whereas the one you're writing down is 1910. I'll show you that one in a minute, but the picture's got the names on. So here you can see there's two Gibson girls. You can see there's two surnames there that say Gibson. This is one of them here, and that's the other one there. This is our Vera, so she's had an injury by now, and so she's the coach. And then these are all the others in their Kent outfits. Right, I'll read your poem and you can fill in the gaps. So it's called Kent at Play. Arthur wrote in January 1911. Let me just tell you. So the siblings wrote a Christmas budget at the end of each year. So as well as the budget, which went around about four times a year, when it came to Christmas, they're saying, let's do something special, write some poems, write something interesting that's more of a special flavour. And that was in the Christmas budget. And this is what Bernard wrote for it. Arthur wrote, Bernard's Kent at Play has gained him some notoriety. I'm now pointed out as a brother of the poet, as well as a brother of Miss Cox. It was suggested that Bernard should be present as a waiter at the Kent dinner when the poem was read out, but his courage was not quite equal to it. Over the Christmas holidays, we gave up 2 days gladly to watching Vera beat Middlesex and Sussex. So it's not the team, it's saying Vera beat them. Right, here's the poem. Have a go at filling in some of the names if you want to. The Kentish team, one winter's day, went up to town to see a play. But previously at 7 o'clock, they all had dinner at the Trock. They all donned regulation dress, some rather more, some rather less. But one and all came up to scratch. In all the East, Kent have no match. But still they did not miss their game. The play took place, though just the same. And they took their places for the play. The play came off, though strange to say, the play was on and may, I hear, continue on throughout the year. But even the pen of Eustace White could not describe the wondrous sight. When 20 girls began to die, their work was very smart. In fine, sometimes I really longed to say, oh, very neatly put away. And some of them who didn't care worked their way through the bill of fare. Truly delightful, said one dame, there are no fowls to spoil the game. But where's the turkey? Oh, don't chaff. Why, Anna Eckenstein's left half. The greatest feature of the feast, a huge jam roll, 6 feet at least, was greeted mid the noise and din, with cheers and cries, roll in, roll in. Miss Hatton, with a modest laugh, offered to take the centre half, while Molly Gibson did aver, the outside always fell to her. Oh, don't complain, just think a while, Irene said with patient smile. Your side is always right, you see. The one that's left is given to me. Then Vera, feeling quite replete, essayed to stand upon her feet, announcing, I feel satisfied. At all events, I'm right inside. Then Captain Barbara arose, remarking in a tone that froze, "Unless we get at least a snack, Olive and I at once go back." But Mrs. Wilcox sent her forward, saying, "It's time that we moved doorward." So having said their various graces, they all went off to find their places. To take the corner, Molly tried. "Come out of that," her sister cried. "Your place is already fixed. I think we're getting rather mixed. The play is somewhat of a farce. Why don't you to the centre pass?" I need not now describe the play. 'Twas rather slow at first, they say, but quickened up towards the end. The team their homeward way did wend, but one was missing when the train started to take them home again. They called the roll, then Barbara cried, "Miss Collins must be left inside." 'Twas in the circle, I declare, I saw her doing up her hair. Great comp! Perhaps she doesn't know. I'm sure she can't have seen us go. Then Winnie said, "I've got a hack, but all the same, I'll go half back. Perhaps I'll meet her on the way." "I think perhaps you'd better stay, for here she comes," said Vera Clay. "The long-sought goal she has attained. Isn't it time that we entrained?" The whistle blew, and off they went, a festive reunited Kent. So they love poems. They thought that was absolutely delightful. The siblings thought that was so entertaining. And you'll see the Kent 11. So Vera Clay is in goal. Barbara Gibson and Olive Mance are the backs. Then you've got Winnie Addiscott, Joyce Hatton, who was great friends with Alba, Anna Eckenstein. And then you've got Molly Gibson. There's the two Gibson girls who played hockey for years. Then Vera, Mrs. Wilcox, Nellie Collins, and Irene Carpenter. And it says, some of the matches are played at great comp. So this is the typed version that was in the Christmas budget that they got typed up in 1910. And the editor, which is Bernard, so he's talking about himself. "The editor does not vouch for the truth of the incidents narrated above. Neither does he approve of the somewhat free use made of the lady's Christian names. The author assures him, however, that he's applied for and obtained a poetic license from the Kent County Council." So Bernard is saying the editor is not very happy with the author when, of course, he's both. So yeah, you don't use women's ladies' name. They were all Miss Cox and Miss Clay, and Bernard's a bit shocking in using the first names of the ladies. So there we go. That's the 1910 team. Bernard had a sense of humour. Yes. Right, where are we up to now? 1910, 1911. This is another picture of Kent. So this one's not been colourised. You can see they're all wearing the navy outfits. This is Vera here. Joyce Hatton, who comes up loads, is there. You've got the two Gibson girls, that one and that one. They were all great friends. Vera has just been for a delightful 10 days at Weston-super-Mare. This was one thing we found today. I'll just tell you before we go on. So I arrived today, and I said, "I'd love to go through your archive and see what you've got." And Marcus at one point brought out some books and said, "I found these, they've got some old photos in, they've got some old photos of hockey, let's have a look and see who they are." And I start flipping through it, and I think, I recognise that handwriting. And then carried on looking, and then I think this could be Vera's handwriting. I'm like, how on earth could this be Vera's handwriting in here in the Hockey Museum? You know, when she died in 1973, why would her scrapbooks be here? But then I looked at some of the letters on my phone and saw that the way she wrote her A, the way she wrote her capital E, the style of it, and it's Vera's scrapbooks. So what she had done is every single photo, every news article, and she'd handwritten all the teams, all the names of the teams, who played for Kent, who played for England, who was the reserve, what the goals were. So from 1908 through to 1912 in these three books upstairs. And we've no idea how they're here, because they were in a folder and hadn't yet been catalogued. It didn't say Vera on it. She hadn't said, "This is my hockey research." She just included it all, and it was the fact that I noticed the handwriting. Then it's Vera, and it's just absolutely astonishing. So she died in 73. Her female companion died in 1978. And I wouldn't be surprised if someone after that was clearing the house and thought, there's some hockey memorabilia here, let's keep that safe. And somehow it's found its way down here. So she describes in this scrapbook upstairs all about this hockey week at Weston-super-Mare. So often they had where loads and loads of hockey girls went and they spent a whole week playing hockey and all the teams played each other and they had a thoroughly jolly time. And it's this team here, the 1910 Kent team that goes, and she writes all about it in this letter. So this is 1911. This is Vera's letter. I got home last night after a delightful 10 days at Weston-super-Mare. It's a rather curious feeling being one of a multitude of girls, although some of them were perhaps rather too elderly for that title. There were 100 or more, and your own personality was more or less sunk. You were known by your county and hailed as Kent. In the club and in the street, you talked to any girl you wanted to, regardless of any introduction of any sort. I sometimes wondered what one's home people would think if they could see us. They would probably have been a bit shocked at seeing girls strolling about bareheaded, arm in arm, and hailing each other across the street. But there was practically no rowdyism, and I think there will be very few people in Weston who would have anything disagreeable to say about the hordes of hockey girls. The inhabitants of Weston-super-Mare turned up in large numbers to watch the games. They displayed a keen interest, from little gutter snipes to elderly dames in their carriages. Sometimes there was rather an undesirable element in the crowd, but this was only noticeable on early closing days. Kent always had a good crowd watching. We came top of the tournament all right, with 5 wins and 1 draw. So they played Wiltshire and Gloucester and Somerset and Cornwall and Devon and Sussex. 5 of them they won, and then 1 was a draw. The headquarters of the hockey was Huntley's Hotel, and there were 2 very big rooms thrown into one, which was called the club. Everyone had to pay 2 shillings to become a member and to be entitled to all its privileges. It was a very comfortable place with tables and easy chairs, all the better known papers and periodicals and writing requisites. There was generally a crowd of people around the notice board where the hours of play were put up each night. Sussex and Wiltshire put up in the hotel, but it's only a small place, so Kent had a boarding house to ourselves, 3 minutes walk away, and we went to the hotel for meals. We had a sitting room in our boarding house, which was rather nice. I don't know what we should have done without it, as the beginning of the week, when every moment was filled up with rehearsals for our entertainment. The day simply flew, you never had any time to spare. We had breakfast at 9, afterwards there was generally a rush for the local papers, and then the London ones, and swarms of girls were always writing swarms of postcards. Before you knew where you were, it was time to start for the morning match at 11, either to play or to watch. 3 matches took place each day, either 2 in the morning and 1 in the afternoon, or vice versa. It was usually arranged that the Kent match was a solitary one, if at all possible, as all the other counties wanted to watch us. We played in a public place, Clarence Park, where 2 very good grounds adjoined each other. The ground was about 20 minutes walk from the hotel. There were always a fair number of people who walked, but the majority crowded into one huge chartered motor bus, which started 10 minutes before a match to the ground, and 10 minutes after the match on the return journey. It was simply marvellous, the amount of people that bus held. The crowds of hockey players and others watching the matches were very enthusiastic, and in a really exciting match, there was often an almost continuous roar. Penny trumpets, drums and tin whistles figured largely whenever a goal was scored. In one Kent match I was watching, I was sitting on a seat with a lot of the Sussex team, and we all had penny instruments of some sort. At half time, a photographer from Ladies Field rushed up and said, "One moment, ladies, please, I want a photograph of the band." And he solemnly proceeded to take us. By the time you changed and had lunch, you were off again for the afternoon match. And then came the most enjoyable time of the day, when everyone assembled for tea, either at the hotel or in a good cafe, and talked over the events of the day. Dinner was at 7, and the entertainment usually started about 8. Each county gave an at home, which lasted till about 9:30, and everyone was supposed to be off to bed by 10. We generally adjourned to our sitting room at 9:30 and had tea and bread and butter around the fire. One always seemed ready for food and sleep at Weston. Wiltshire and Devon both gave competition entertainments. Cornwall gave a dance. Somerset and Sussex gave the fancy dress dance. Gloucester did some acting, and Kent did a variety entertainment. We were very much complimented over ours, and were told it was the best thing that had ever been done at Weston, so we were rather pleased. We'd certainly taken a lot of trouble, and on the night everyone came up to the scratch nobly. The audience was so enthusiastic, and I don't believe anyone enjoyed it more than ourselves. We had a Bigot Phone Band, Action Songs, and Mrs. Janky's Waxworks. Bigot phones are big cardboard instruments, gilded over and made to look like brass instruments, and you sing into them and they make a noise, rather the same as you get by blowing on a comb through a piece of paper, only much more effective. We did several well-known marches and tunes. The best one was the Boy Scout one. Six of us dressed up as Boy Scouts and acted according to the words of the song. For our bigger firm one, we wore short white tennis skirts, white blouses, red ties with Peter Pan collars, red sashes, red stockings, black shoes, and a big coon hat with a red scarf. I don't think we could have hit on a more becoming dress for everyone. On Thursday evening, the West team was read out, and as each name was read, the girl had to get up and go and get her badge from the president. It was a most exciting evening, and everyone cheered and clapped till they were exhausted. The sports prizes were given too, and there were speeches. The fancy dress dance was a great success. There were some very good dresses. There was a prize for the most original dress of the evening and the best dress of the evening, and prizes for the prettiest dress in each county. Halfway through the evening, the counties were marshalled up and had to process around the room in turn, and then afterwards you voted for the dresses. Kent, in the person of Irene Carpenter, dressed as a Dutch wooden doll, got the prize for the most original dress. I got the county prize for the prettiest dress, wearing Alice's dress from the Chester pageant, which is certainly very becoming. Wednesday was given up to sports. They were very well managed, and Kent did fairly well, with first prize in the hurdle race, second and third in the obstacle, and second race in the hobble race. The obstacle race was the event in the afternoon, as there was a gold watch bracelet offered by the ladies' field for first prize. There were a great number of entries for it, and it was a really good test. I am conceited enough to think I might have won it, or at any rate been second, if it had not been run in heats. As it was, I only got third place in the final. Joyce beat me by half a foot for second place. I won my heat easily, but I had not enough stamina for the final. Twice round a rather long course is rather too much of a good thing unless you were very fit. Colonel Lear, the President of the West, managed everything beautifully from beginning to end, and yet he never fussed or was at all bossy. It was a rather curious position to be the one man amongst so many girls. I've written myself silly, and yet there's heaps more I could say, but I will refrain. So the amazing things about that letter is we found loads upstairs today that verifies it. She talked about the obstacle race, and you think they're just jumping over things. But no, there were things where they were climbing up to about like 2 meters up there, and then there's pictures of these girls kind of tumbling off down the other side, and Vera has labelled who all the people are. Another one they got with the obstacle race was they had hoops, and you had two hoops, and you had to bowl them along quite a long course, but your competitor was only... was absolutely right next to you. So you'd have all these hoops bumping into each other, and each girl had to get two hoops along and not bump into the girl next to them. So as well as doing all this hockey, you've got all these races, and Vera's saying, I could have done it if we did it just like, but we had heats and you had to go twice round, and they're jumping up these huge things. It's quite staggering, really, if you think what they organised. This photo, again, we found upstairs. This is the photo of the band that the ladies' field photographer took at half-time, where he's like, come on ladies, I want a photo of the band, and proceeded to take us. They often talk about that with photographs. We were taken in a group shot, and was how they said we took a photograph, we were taken. So this is the Sussex team here. This is Vera and Joyce. I don't quite know which is which, but the siblings then talk about it later and say, oh, Joyce looks the most sensible of the lot. And basically what they're saying is that the Kent ladies are a little bit more upper class, they're a bit more wealthy, they're a little bit more sensible and restrained, and that Sussex are a bit more common. So I think Sussex were probably shop girls, whereas Kent are mostly middle class young ladies who don't work. And you can see from what they're wearing that Joyce and Vera, they're wearing big coats. This was January and it was freezing. They've got fur around the jackets and a big hat. And the Sussex girls, the coats and hats look a little bit cheaper. And so I think you've got this snobbishness of the middle class, wealthier teams and the more working class other teams. Something else I saw in the one upstairs is that in this week, a couple of days, it had to stop because there was snow and ice on the pitch. So they then went and played on sand. And there are some photos upstairs of them playing hockey on the beach at Weston-super-Mare because there was too much ice and they decided they couldn't play there. I've never heard of hockey being played on sand. I mean, the ball would sink. Would it work?
No, it's not sand. We've written quite a few articles on it.
Really? Okay, I've never heard of that. That was new to me. Right, so this is the band. Penny instruments, so you can see them all playing the penny instruments. If you moved in an old photo, it went all blurry. So you can see this woman here and this one here. That if you moved, because obviously the photo, I think they like took over a minute or something. If you didn't keep still, the photo was blurry. So there they are playing the penny instruments. Joyce hats, big hats, and coats. Neville describes watching East playing West at grade comp. So he's back on holiday from South Africa. And he says the Heron Maxwells gave lunch to about 60 and tea to about 90 and treated everyone grandly. Neville continues, on Wednesday, Vera was in a great state of excitement, waiting for the telegram about the English team. So this is 1911. We just sat down to tea when the telegram arrived, and Vera's joy was great when she found she was in, but she was very disappointed to find that Vera Clay was not picked for goal, nor Mrs. Wilcox for centre forward. I think most people expected Mrs. Wilcox to be chosen, as Miss Henderson has played very poorly this year. It was very hard luck on Vera Clay. Miss Carpenter, the Kent and East left wing, was chosen for England as well. So it looks like Vera got a telegram saying she was in the England team at the end of February 1911, but then a week later in March, there must have been a second telegram, because there's an announcement in the budget that she's captain for England. I am captain for England, so that's Sydney, March 2nd, 1911. This is Neville's writing underneath. Vera is too busy nursing father to find time to write a letter. The photo she puts in does not show many of the instruments. The lady in the back row behind the one blowing the whistle is whirling a rattle. A penny drum is next to the whistler. Joyce Hatton is next to Vera. So he's commenting on the photo of the band, which has been included in. But this is a forgery. In April, Bernard confessed that this page was a forgery. He was very good at copying handwriting, and no one ever noticed. Vera was far too busy nursing grumpy Dr. Cox, who was upstairs sick, and Bernard thought such an achievement ought to be recorded in the budget for posterity. So that's Bernard forging his sister's handwriting and saying we should have it in there. So Dr. Cox had got erysipelas. I'd never heard of this before. It's a skin complaint, kind of like eczema, except it's very, very infectious. Of course, it doesn't exist nowadays because we've got antibiotics, but back then they didn't. So this poor man was confined to his bedroom for 3 weeks with an infectious disorder. They got nurses in because Vera couldn't cope because she was too busy playing hockey for England. So they got nurses in. And it was so infectious that they had to burn all the jigsaws that he'd used. All the cups and saucers had to be disinfected. Visitors weren't allowed to go in. And the funny thing is that one of the nurses wanted to talk about religion. So Dr. Cox was an Anglican vicar, and this nurse who came in was a Wesleyan, and she wanted to talk about church. And the nurse wanted to know if Dr. Cox believed in purgatory. She was a Wesleyan, and he replied, "I think I'm in it now." Then there was a row, and that nurse left in tears, but Enid said the other two nurses were very nice women. Presumably they needed to keep their mouths shut and not to annoy the clergyman who's trapped in his room and can't escape. I'm in purgatory now, I think that's great. Right, this is another one that Gloria's colourised. She said that she can't make the programme do what I asked. So the skirts are supposed to be scarlet because this is the England team. And she says the colour programme she uses won't let you pick colours. But it gives you some idea with the faces. It brings it out a lot more. There's Vera in the middle. So this is when she's captain for England. And we've got all the names of everyone else who's there. Mrs. Wilcox, Miss Carpenter, all the names that I mentioned before. 1911. Bernard said...
How old is she there?
How old is she there? So we're in 1911, 84, 94, 16... I think she's 27. She has the injury in 1912 when she was 28. So she's 27 now. So this is 1911, and again we've got the Richmond match, which was every March. It was England versus Ireland. Vera was the captain, and it was a good match. England won 4-3. Vera and Miss Bryant played well together, and Bernard thought Vera, Miss Bryant and Miss Carpenter were the best players. Joyce Hatton was staying for the weekend. She was instructing Vera as to proper garments to wear at golf, which Bernard said was a very serious matter. So Vera played golf as well. There's Vera Hatton on that one, but she's not in that picture. Mm-hmm. So maybe Joyce hadn't got in this time. Vera mentions the upcoming match in Ireland on the 19th of March. Oh, we're now in 19... Oh, no, I'm getting muddled. We're now into 1912. There's a fabulous quote from Vera. I'm still bubbling over with excitement at having got into the English team once more. I feel much more like going out to help the idiotic suffragettes break shop windows than settling down to writing a sensible letter. I felt pretty sure I should get into the England team again, and yet I'm almost as excited as the first time I got in. There's always loads of conversation about suffragettes. They didn't like the militant aspect of it. Some of them sympathised with the suffragettes wanting a vote, but they thought the militant aggressiveness was absolutely shocking and not the done thing. So this is March 1912, just before she has her injury. Have I got a 1912? Oh, that's that one. So I haven't got one of the 1912. Vera mentions the match in Ireland on the 19th of March, and then the Scotland match a week later. But she doesn't get there because she then has the injury. She says the East really have had rather bad luck in losing three of their matches by the odd goal. They've not distinguished themselves under the first year of my captaincy. We had a very jolly tour in February, playing the West at Cheltenham, then up to Liverpool to play the North. In each case, we lost 4-3, and in each case, we were the better team, only our opponent's goalkeepers excelled themselves. Now it's 1912, and this photo was in Ladies' Field that was put into the budget. Vera's not in it, but her two sisters are. So I'm not sure which is which, but that's Abbas and Enid watching the match. So this is North versus East playing in Liverpool. So you can see they've got Vera's hockey stick, it's half time. All hockey players are talking to all their friends and family before they then go on and play the next one. Vera's last hockey match for England was in March in Dublin, where England played Ireland. Her knee injury happened in that match. But I've written down here, this is me writing a month ago, Katie's told us some more today. It was probably a hockey injury as swarms of hockey girls came to the family home to see how Vera was doing. We've worked out today and found where it was written in Ladies' Field that it was a knee injury and she was taken off the field halfway through the match and then the team had to finish one person down. And she'd hurt her knee, and so she then didn't play, and she never played for England again. She's terribly sad. This is a photo from Ladies' Field, which Enid put into the budget. So this is the last match that Vera played before her injury, which is in Liverpool. And Enid says, I see in the Times this morning that the English ladies beat Irish ladies at Dublin by 7-0. Well done, Vera. We're all proud of having the English captain as our sister. Vera wrote in the margin, it was 8-0, not 7-0. Correcting her sister for not getting the score correct. So this was just before she had her last match when she was injured. Abbas and Enid are the two women sitting down holding Vera's hockey stick. On 7th of April. See, they don't mention sickness in the budget. It wasn't the done thing to mention anything to do with health. British stuff, stiff upper lip and all that, you don't say anything about illness. So they don't mention the fact that she's ill or she's had this knee injury that's catastrophic and she can't play for England anymore. A month later, Bernard says, Vera is still at the nursing home. She took her operation quite as a matter of course and was very plucky about it. I should not at all like to have only a local anaesthetic. She has swarms of sympathisers. In fact, so many girls called here at first that the police began to think Christabel Pankhurst was concealed here. So Vera obviously knew all the hockey girls. They all knew she was captain for England and were horrified that she was ill and that she'd had an operation and she'd missed the England match and she was the popular captain and they all came to the family house and Bernard's a bit shocked. There's too many girls calling at the front door, I'm not happy. Arthur said in April 1912, I'm rather moved to make some comments on the Titanic and on Vera's misfortune, but it's bedtime and this notepaper is too gross. So there's this one little brief mention, no one mentions the Titanic. You know, what do you think about it? He's like, I'm tired, I've got terrible notepaper. And I'm saying, you could have said something about the Titanic. And Vera's misfortune, so all we've got is that she had misfortune. We now know that she had some sort of knee injury, but don't know exactly what. Right, so we're now in the 1920s. Dr. Cox has died in 1919, so Vera's now moved into Great Conf. That is probably Mr. Harry Maxwell with her there. She was still playing hockey in 1912, but the injury wasn't too bad because she was still playing at Great Comp. I don't have time for that long letter now, I don't think. But I'll just briefly tell you some of it. So this is Great Comp and the big house, and the hockey leagues are still going. In this one, she said, the maids would bring tea and bread and butter to the bedrooms at 7:45. Then there was a scramble for bathroom, breakfast at 9. Then three matches every day, lunch for about 60 in the gymnasium, tea for about 90. Then the Atalanta team, who were staying in the house, relaxed before dinner. Everyone changed into an evening dress, and after dinner there were entertainments put on every night. Mrs. McLaren and Mrs. Maxwell were born organisers and everything ran smoothly. The Pilgrims, who were the local team, I mentioned, Vera was coaching them in 1912, and she doesn't mention her knee injury at all. So I think that she had some injury. She had had some sort of operation, because Bernard said she had a local anaesthetic, and wow, she was very plucky. But the injury wasn't so bad, it stopped her playing hockey. I reckon she couldn't run fast enough. So she's still playing for the local team. She's good enough to do that, but maybe she can't run fast enough to be in the England team, which is why she doesn't go back. So Vera's now living at Great Comp with Mrs. Maxwell. Then Mr. Heron Maxwell dies, and it's just Mrs. Maxwell and Vera who live there. Vera is now coaching. She's an umpire for territorial and international matches. Vera becomes the daughter Max never had. She drives Max's car all over England, going to hockey matches as an umpire and a selector. That's her in 1928. Where am I to? I'm lost. Right, this is a great picture. I think this is probably a Great Comp, and they're now into cricket because she's wearing cricket whites in the middle. So that's Joyce on the left. Surprising that's all women, although you wouldn't actually think to look at it. Joyce on the left, Vera in the middle, and this is Mrs. Maxwell, who was an immensely strange character. Absolutely fascinating. And so my friend Canada, Gloria, put some colour into that as well. She doesn't like the red jumper at all, but said the programme did that automatically and she couldn't stop it doing that. It wouldn't have been that colour, it would have been like a dark green or a grey or something. But it's fascinating how just a bit of colour brings them to life. I love Mrs. Maxwell, that cardigan and a tie and a shirt and tie, and she looks a bit formidable, doesn't she? You wouldn't want to argue with her. She was the sort of woman
that
who
badge. Would... We could check that with the women's cricket, couldn't we? Or is that as an official?
Yeah, I'm sure it's. It's her white hockey, because the previous one where you've got her wearing the white, this was probably like an umpire's outfit.
Yeah.
It looks like it. I wouldn't be surprised, but I'm not sure. Mm. But yeah, we need to check. She wears that white coat a lot. And that, I think, it's either hockey or it's cricket. Mm. I think it's probably cricket, isn't it? Because of the white dress underneath. But they were doing both. Mm. They were doing loads of it. Right, this is Vera winning. She won everything. This is her winning the family croquet match. So we've got 1925. And the family are all on holiday in Cornwall. The house is owned by Carr, who's one of their cousins. She was the suffragette who was involved with the poet Rupert Brooke, the First World War poet who died. So their cousin was a suffragette who was fully, fully suffragette. They're all taking photos of Vera's winning shot. So this is all the family. And you can see there's 1, 2, 3 cameras taking photos of Vera, who's about to win a croquet. She won everything. But it also is an indication that they were comfortably wealthy because you've got all those cameras. And then this next one here, there she is. She's the Cuthbert, who's the headmaster of Birkenhead, said he's congratulating and saying, yeah, I'm no good, you win at everything. These are the sons of Arthur who are jumping up and down and making it fuzzy. So there's quite a few of the siblings in this. This is Arthur, who's the headmaster of Inverness. Then that's Cuthbert, who's the headmaster of Birkenhead. Bernard, who's the poet, he's the stockbroker in London, who's the very funny. Aldwyn is the African missionary who lives in Africa. Basically comes back every 4 years for a holiday, and they talk about his yellow malarial complexion. He always looks a bit yellow and then goes back to Africa again. So yeah, that's Vera winning at everything. She won at hockey and cricket and tennis and golf. And that's in Athlete probably, isn't it? Interesting person. So that's a colourised one of the white jacket she's wearing. And I wouldn't be surprised if that's some sort of official uniform. I'll need to find out. I wouldn't be surprised if it's like cricket umpire or something like that. So this is this absolutely glorious house that's still there, looking out over the cliff in Cornwall. And it was Carr's house, and they borrowed it for the summer. Mrs. Max and Vera go on holiday. They're wealthy women. They go to Switzerland. They walk for about 4 weeks every summer. They pay for guides. It's that comfortable, wealthy existence. Mrs. Maxwell there. So there's two guys, and Mrs. Maxwell has a lunch halt on the something. Can't read that bit enlarged from the snaps. It's 1926. And then that's Vera there with the hobnail boots, and Mrs. Max there on the right. That's another one that's got colour eyes. That's the first time I've seen Vera in something resembling trousers. That's 1928. And the family wrote comments, oh, don't you look magnificent, up there in Switzerland, posing for the camera. Here's another one of Joyce. So Joyce Hatton was another of the hockey women, and they were great friends. And the siblings think this is hilarious, because these women are actually only in their early 40s, but they look like they're about 70. So at the top here, old women. So what they do, they'd stick photos in the budget, and then everyone would write comments as it got posted around. Oldwin, who's the African missionary, he says, I had the least idea that this was Vera till I was told, and even now I can hardly believe it. It is a wicked libel. Joyce, too, looks like a forbidding dame of 60. And underneath, Bernard has written, how this will be laughed at in 1950. So that was 1929, wearing their tweed jacket. So it's Vera on the left and Joyce on the right. Vera is now thoroughly involved in both cricket and hockey. It was very common for people to do both, because obviously you do hockey in the winter and then you do cricket in the summer. But as people got older or they got injured, they moved over to cricket more often because of an injury, or they couldn't run as fast, or it was a little bit hockey for the younger people who are fitter, will move over to cricket because you don't have to run quite so fast. And there were huge numbers of women who moved from hockey into cricket. So there's Joyce at the top right. Honestly, that's a female, not a male. I couldn't quite believe it until I was sure. Vera's here. That's Vera here. This is her friend Olive Andrews, who is a games mistress up at St. Leonard's School in St. Andrews, which was one of those schools that did loads and loads of sport. I think the other one is at Bedford, down in the south, where there were the real centres of sport for women, and trained them all up. And that's where she was based. And they eventually end up in a relationship, which we worked it out. Max considered Vera her first daughter and Olive was her second daughter. And then when Mrs. Max dies, she leaves her money to all of them. So that's Olive. Vera calls her Bill, oh, I don't know why. So that's Olive, otherwise known as Bill, on the right. And Nora Strathairn was another hockey professional. I think she was Scottish. So they both played, I think they both played hockey for Scotland. I think one of them played lacrosse. They were the two games teachers at St. Leonard's up in St. Andrews. And Olive is the one who's very close to Vera. They'd known each other for decades. Olive was a school teacher, but was often down at Great Comp during the school holiday. Right, there she is in the 1950s. It's a lovely picture. I think that was the photo that was used when she retired. Max dies in 1955 in Switzerland, and Vera was there. Vera inherits Great Comp with vast, vast amounts of money. I think it was something like £50,000 in the 1950s, which was a colossal amount of money to inherit. But then Vera sells it. She doesn't want to stay down south. She moves to St. Andrews with Olive, possibly because there was no social scene out there and you could live a nice, quiet life, and two females living quietly could hide underneath the radar. Max intended her money to support Vera for the rest of her life, and then Olive to be comfortable as well. So the money was passed on. And there, Gloria's colorized again. I need to get someone who's really good to get rid of the barbed wire across the skirt. That will make it even better. But, so that's her in the 1950s. So Christopher, one of the cousins, described how these two women, Vera and Olive, would be glued to the radio for the cricket, especially when the test match was on, and they were still insisting their choice of players should have been selected. Obviously, Vera had done lots of selecting when she was younger. I always suspected that Vera and Bill were in a relationship, especially when I looked at wills and probate and saw that they'd left their money to each other. But British stiff upper lip and all that. In the early letters, it's quite clear that discussing health was not the done thing. They use phrases such as, like, I had pain in my little Mary. I'd never heard of that phrase until I looked it up. Little Mary means your stomach. So if you said you had a pain in your little Mary, it's saying you have a pain in your stomach, but it wasn't the done thing to mention health. It was quite frowned upon, so they used words that weren't body parts because you didn't talk about body parts. Quite fascinating. So there was no way they were going to talk about relationships if they can't even mention health. I now know that some of the brothers were definitely gay. I don't believe Vera was aware she was gay when she was young, because there were comments like, when I have a son, he will go to Arthur's school. So it's fascinating, I just don't know. And then I've got down here, Katie put me in touch with Jane Claydon. She was on the staff at St. Leonard's School, which is the school at St. Andrew's, and she knew Olive. So Olive is Bill. There's no photo of them together, really. That's as good as you get together. So that's Vera. Olive, who's known as Bill, was at the back. So Jane, who was at St. Leonard's School, knew Olive in the 1970s when she was an old, retired games mistress. She used to wear a tweed suit and tie. Olive died a few years after Vera. Jane was asked to go to their house with an older woman from the school to collect things that belonged to the school, cricket balls, things like that. Olive hadn't sorted anything out. Jane remembers finding a roll of paper tied up with red ribbon, which said St. Leonard's letters. Some said Dear Bill, and it became clear that Bill was Olive and the two women had been in a relationship. Jane was young, and the old woman took the bundle, put them in a bag, and Jane said they were thrown away. It's sad from a historical research perspective, but I'm glad I know, and that they had a happy retirement, even though the world had no idea. And it actually feels like a real privilege to be able to tell them their story in a day where we can say, yes, there were two women who was gay, and that was fine. But the world wasn't ready for that in the 1970s and they couldn't tell anyone. Jane Claydon knew a woman called Valerie who lived next door to Vera and Bill in St. Andrews. And there's a lovely anecdote from this lady who lived next door in the 1970s. So this woman said about Bill, I was fascinated by the pictures of a very young Miss Olive Andrews in your book. She and her friend Vera were my neighbours many years ago. My groceries were constantly and mistakenly delivered to their door. I loved going to collect them, as they had a delightful secret garden behind high hedges. Regularly in the summer, the elderly Miss Andrews, wild grey Eton crop on end, cigarette dangling from the corner of her mouth, skinny legs encased in thick woolen stockings, emerging from a baggy tweed skirt, and sporting her English lady's cricket blazer, was to be seen on the pavement, perched on a high ladder, clipping away at the hedge. She had spunk. So this woman who lived next door is describing these two old ladies who both were wearing these tweed jackets and tweed skirts and a shirt and tie in the 1970s, which would look very odd with what everyone else was wearing in the 1970s. Or they were wearing their English cricket blazer, you know, cigarette hanging out your mouth, clipping the hedge. And she said, I live next door to these remarkable women. You know, it's quite bizarre. Vera died in 1973, Bill died in 1978, and we've now worked out that those scrapbooks probably came to here after Olive died, because there's some stuff in them from Scotland, which seems to fit with the fact that they were up there, and somehow they've come down here, but we haven't worked that bit out yet. Sir Christopher was one of the cousins who eventually put this huge archive into the Bodleian, and he wrote in the 1970s some of his recollections in the letters. He shared his memories with the other cousins. He remembered being 10 years old when he couldn't believe that his Aunt Vera was captain of England. And his quote is, I basked in her glory shamelessly in impressionable company all my days. One of his fondest memories of Aunt Vera in her last few years was visiting her in St. Andrews, and she was wearing a powder blue tweed coat and skirt. He described it as the blue of the sky above sunny snowfields. The jacket and skirt were from her earlier days, and she carried it off superbly. And this is the quote from Sir Christopher. Despite all the off days at St. Andrews, it was a wonderful last phase of a wonderful life, and we shall continue to live in the glow of our memories of her. So these are the cousins. This is the next generation who are very proud of their Aunt Vera. There are decades of letters I've not read yet. So all these budget letters go from 1906 to the 1980s. I've only got up to the 1920s, so I can't wait to find out what Vera got up to next. I know that she was involved with the Women's Land Army during the war, that they were watching dogfights overhead during the Blitz, and they basically had an amazing view in Kent of the war going on in the skies above. I'll get those letters when I get to read them. So there's loads about hockey and cricket and coaching and umpiring and all the war years and the Women's Land Army. If you've enjoyed this, maybe I'll have to come back again when I can fill in some more of the gaps. I need to go back to the Bodleian Library to get some more photos. Hockey was Vera's first love. She only stopped due to a knee injury at the age of 28 in 1912. I want to finish with something which Vera wrote for the Christmas budget in 1909, where she describes how much she loves hockey. Let me just move to that one. That's right there. Right, so Vera wrote in 1909, this is why she loved hockey so much. She called it the joys of hockey. I think there is little doubt that hockey, I can't read this, that's far too dark. I've got it there. I think there is little doubt that hockey is an almost ideal game for girls and women. It's better than golf or tennis, the two other most popular outdoor games for women, in that you play for your side rather than for yourself. Who, for instance, after an afternoon's play at tennis or golf, can come home after having played below form and yet say they've thoroughly enjoyed themselves? And yet at hockey this can truthfully be said if only your side has won. Not that individual prowess does not count, but rather it's subordinated to the whole, and your own particular play, good or otherwise, does not loom so large in your eyes as the play of your side as a team and considered collectively. But apart from the game itself, the social side is one of the most enjoyable features. There's such a general feeling of good comradeship, and as you rise from club to county, and maybe territorial and international honours, you make more and more friends, and know and are known by hundreds of girls all over England. You make a vast circle of acquaintances, with whom it's always a pleasure to meet, and such acquaintances occasionally ripen into real friends. The club tour, the county tournaments, the territorial and international matches all give rise to social intercourse in a way that no other game affords. Then, speaking broadly, you meet a very pleasant type of girl at hockey, a little inclined to slang, perhaps, and occasionally somewhat deficient in manners, but you meet the real person, honest and open as the day, who expresses her opinions in an outspoken way, is on the lookout for doing a good turn to anyone, and without any of the affectation that is so often met with in the modern world. There's a great deal of innocent fun and chaff, and well-worn jokes that never fail to amuse, and with it all, everything's taken in the kindness and best of spirits. As for the game itself, personal experience is necessary before its fascination can be fully understood. A good game of hockey is an outlet for all the little worries and annoyances of the day. The glorious feeling of the springy turf, the race for the ball, the effort to outwit an opponent, the real hard struggle to win the game, and the thrilling moment when the winning goal is shot, all unite to promote keenness, endurance, good temper and good health, and certainly tend to develop character. So that's what Vera thought. She thought hockey was a great game and it develops character. And from what I've read about Vera, she was a woman with character, and it's like, of course she's interesting, and I can't wait to find out what else you've got in your archives, because I'm sure there's some more gems out there that are going to be discovered.
I think so, certainly for Kent, you've got a lot of women who are from quite well-to-do homes. That Vera mentions a lot of her friends where we went to play tennis at the Gibsons and they got three courts until we could play six sets. And these were women who had a daddy who earns a lot of money. And I suspect a lot of them were women who didn't work, especially from Kent. And it's this slightly outrageous thing for us where Vera is saying that Kent is a little bit more genteel than Sussex, who's more of shop girls, and they're a bit more working class. And you've got the issue of that the Vera and her friends had money because they've got a dad that worked enough and that supported them. For Vera, she then went to live with Mrs. Maxwell, who basically supported her her whole life. I don't think Vera ever worked for money. I think she might have earned something with the Women's Land Army in the war, but for nothing else, and maybe the hockey coaching. But I think as a selector and as an umpire, I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of that was voluntary. I don't know. Voluntary would have been paid.
No, voluntary. There's no payment.
So for Vera, she got family, and then there was Mrs. Maxwell who supported her. And I think a lot of the Kent women were girls from wealthy homes. But then they talk a lot about, oh, the shop girls are starting to play now, and they're a very different type of character. And that's the start where you've got the First World War, and it moves. It's just everything changes with the war, doesn't it? That the women go out to work, and then they don't expect to stay home anymore, and then the rich, it's not such a class divide. The issue of servants starts to disappear at the end of the war. So I think there's a lot of stuff about class there. Some of it doesn't age well, and they come across as a bit snobbish, because they were creatures of their time. They were used to servants who did all the work for them, and so they didn't have to, because, hey, they were lucky to be financially secure to have servants.
Yeah, but I think before First World War, definitely, I mean, even the Sussex players would have been for money, or they would have been professional women. You start getting women coming through the universities and going into professions, but the Sussex women wouldn't have been working class or shop girls.
Yeah, they would.
No, they wouldn't. They wouldn't have been. Girls of that class wouldn't have been selected for the county team.
Were they not?
No.
Okay.
They were starting to play hockey, but. The two
were
mixed.
Yeah. So do you think they all just took time off for like this hockey week
Yeah, I mean if they were working the professions, the new professions like law or or if they were a doctor or something, but a lot of them, that would have been a rarity, but a lot of them would have just been from families that could afford for their daughters not to work. Their sons would have gone out and worked, but they would have been daughters.
That's interesting. I've not heard of a hockey week before. I've seen the event at Western Supermare. It's a report in Hockey Field, and you can see all the competition. I always thought it was the West tournament. I hadn't realised it's an invitation tournament with other non-West teams.
Yeah, I don't know why Kent is there, so all the others are...
Sussex, you mentioned as well.
Oh yeah, Sussex is there as well, you're right.
Yeah, so obviously there were other teams. But if you compare it to cricket, until recently there's always been a cricket week. And it could well have started down at Great Comp. And basically everyone goes and plays cricket for a week. And I was always thinking, how the heck do all these people go away for a week? Mm. And this is in modern day, but cricket maybe has a slightly different clientele, but the hockey one was obviously going way back.
Yeah,
it was
like the county tournament.
Yeah. Cricket was also in the summer.
I think that Colonel, whatever his name,
Colonel Lear,
he's quite a character, and there's a lot to be learned about him. He was one of the people fundamental in setting up ladies' hockey in the West, and he came from cricket as well. So I think there's probably a crossover there, right, that he got that going on the basis of what he'd known in the cricket world. But he's a tremendous character and a driving force for women's hockey.
I think without question, at that time, hockey was played by the well-to-do.
Yeah.
And if you think about the 1950s here in men's cricket, there were still gentlemen in the players.
Yeah.
So.
With separate dressing rooms.
You know, if you think about hockey in this part of the world, the traditional clubs came from grammar schools or public schools that were hockey playing schools that then spawned the club. Mm-hmm. So I think that in Vera's time, it would have been a pastime for the world to do.
Mm-hmm. In some of the later letters, there is more discussion about hockey girls and about how they played to the gallery more. Like she mentioned that about Miss Bryant, that they play really well, but they play much better when there's a big audience of young men watching, and comments like that. And it's fascinating the way it sits with us that it's different, but then it was such an issue of class, and class was so, so relevant, wasn't it then?
Reinforced by the fact that earlier on, the ladies' clubs played midweek, so you played it on a Wednesday, and then you find it becomes, say, from the 20s, it started being played early on before the First World War. It's played on a Saturday. So you get it, so it's probably, it's the demographic is changing to people who work who can only play on a Saturday. So, you know, when you see that, that's when you notice that the demographic of the club is changing to people who work and then play at the weekend rather than people who just have got the time and then play midweek.
I flipped through the photos quite quickly. Does anyone want to go back to any particular photos or?
I was going to ask you about the cricket photo at
I think they came from Jane Clayton.
All right. Do you know a date for that exhibit photo?
I think the 1930s.
All right. Because
I think it's 1930s.
The woman in the middle on the right.
Yeah, that
that's Marjorie Pollard.
Is it?
Yes. And that's what looked like it to me. Yes.
Yes.
And the one on the left is Kathleen Doman, who were the women who started off the cricket week at Colwall. So 1926, I think, was when they first set up the cricket. So, so that's not
in the middle row on the
right. So you said 1920, she signed the bail.
Was it
I'm sure there are comments about Marjorie, and when I read all those letters, I'll be able to find out because I know that there was lots of issues. Sometimes they all got on, and sometimes they didn't. Okay, so that's Marjorie there, and behind her is Joyce. Yeah. On that, that's Kathleen Doman, who in Ella was a great
number.
I haven't put names to all the others. And then that one, I'm not sure of the year. So that's Nora Strathairn, the two teachers at St Leonard's.
Mm-hmm. What's her name? I'm at the St Leonard's contact.
Jane.
Did she give you these? Or
yeah,
she
came from her.
They came from her, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think she went and looked through the St Leonard's archive because there's loads and loads of hockey at St Leonard's because that was one of the schools that was producing girls to play sport, and the other one being Bedford down the south.
Was it hockey?
Huh?
Was it hockey?
I think it was because both of them played hockey.
They call it goals.
St Leonard's school invented their own game.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And called it goals.
Okay, I didn't know that.
We got the rules up at the library that they wrote.
But I know that both of them played hockey for Scotland.
Yeah. Well, they went on to play proper hockey, but they started playing.
They did their own version of this. Oh, how interesting.
Are you a hockey player?
I played it at school, but never did anymore.
So I played it in my 40s, late 40s, in Hong Kong. Mm. And, no, I think you're saying it's classy. I think there were such things in that sort of the joys of hockey that made me feel, yes, I want to send that to the women that I played with when I was kind of 40 going on 50 and they were 20 going on 30. Or, you know, there was a whole mix of us.
Yeah.
But it was very, I would say, they found it levelling.
I think they probably did, yes.
Yes.
And that Vera's aware that she can wave penny rattles and stuff that her dad can't see, because her dad would have said that's not the thing for young ladies to do. She's like, well, hey, there's no problem. You know, we don't have to wear a hat in the street. We can call out. We can call each other by Kent. We don't have to say Miss Clay and Miss Cox all the time. And I think she realised that there were lots of fun to be had, and you didn't have to be straight-laced and upper class, but obviously the generation above expected you to do it, so maybe they kept it quiet and didn't tell the older generation that they weren't wearing hats in the street, which wasn't the done thing, obviously, was it? Oh, that's my interpretation of it.
Last question.
I was struck by the fact that the crowd at Old Deer Park was 5,000.
Yeah, that's been written down in several places, so they were huge.
So that was a great attendance.
Yeah.
And it hasn't, I mean, apart from the ladies at Wembley.
Well, they did at the Oval. When the ladies played the Oval in the 30s, they got 10,000 then, and that's why they've had to find someone at Wembley. So AEWOJ worked hard to get crowds to go in those days. So they used to get reasonable crowds. In fact, they got bigger crowds than some of the men. But it then sort of died away.
It really is an insight into how women's hockey grew and expanded and steps on the way to Wembley, if you will.
And there were lots of schoolgirls that went. So that Bernard mentions the schoolgirl saying, oh wow, don't they look amazing? That it wasn't just the older people, it was lots of girls who wanted to go to it. And I think it was because it was the excitement of being an England team. And it's not what we consider now. They didn't really go abroad, they only went to Ireland. you know, they aren't really travelling any great distances. It's like, we're in the England team, we're going to Ireland for an international match, you know, which doesn't quite sound so dramatic to us, does it? You know, it's not like they're going off to the Far East or Australia.
But at the same time, they were the first tours.
But it was the start of it.
Went to Australia in 1914.
Vera was involved in setting up all the cricket ones with the first Australian tour when she moved into the cricket with that.
Well, I've no problem with special service here, but it's been fascinating talk. So thank you very much for.
Well, I'm thoroughly researching it, and it's fascinating coming here for the first time and seeing what we've got up there in your archive.
Beginning of a great
I'll be able to come back when I found out some more next year. I'm going to the bottling next week, so I can get some more letters. So basically, they're all in the bottling, and you have to take pictures and then go away and read them and decipher terrible handwriting to try and work out what it is they're all talking about. But it's very interesting.
So
final thank you.
I'd just like to say a couple of things, if I may.
Mm-hmm.
I've actually captivated you by what you've come up with today, because I think what you've said this evening is encapsulates what the Hockey Museum is all about. And having just stood down as the curator last month, it's so heartwarming for me to see a story come out like this, which is based on exactly what we're doing, trying to conserve and preserve the history of our sport. And you've picked on a particular story, which I venture to suggest you hardly scratch the surface yet.
Yeah, oh, there's so
an awful lot. You mentioned this thing about the jigsaw
puzzle. You find a bit of a puzzle.
And you haven't got halfway yet.
No.
I'm quite convinced of that. We must, on our part, digitise those scrapbooks as a matter of priority when we get the digitisation going, Marcus, because that's going to be a real source for you there. And I'm very much looking forward to seeing what the wartime thing is, so we maybe find a hockey's military story out of that. I'd also be interested to see whether anything comes out on the suffragette side, because we know that group of ladies playing sport were quite important to the suffragette movement in a subversive way, and it'd be interesting to see what comes out there. I was intrigued by the 2 shillings for being able to go into the lounge for the duration of the event. It was 2 shillings in those days, 1911.
It was a lot of money, wasn't it?
That was a phenomenal amount of money.
Yeah.
I mean, you could buy 100 pints of beer for that, probably.
That shows that it was a lot of wealthy young ladies.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Who had some pocket money.
But the one carrot I'll dangle in front of you in your search to create and develop this story is that sometime towards the middle of next year, we should have completed the England Caps project, which means that all those people who play for England, men and women, will receive a cap.
Mm-hmm.
And in this instance, that cap got to go to the family of Vera. And it'd be great to get you back to do part 2 of this story, and for us to be able to give you a Vera's cap as a memento for the family to keep and carry forward. I'm absolutely moved by what you've done, given us this evening. It typifies what we're trying to do here at the museum. It's so rewarding. And for something as strong and as well thought out as you've done to come across. We're only 10, 12 years old as a museum with a building, with a home. And it's great that we can see something like this happening tangibly. So thank you very much indeed.
No worries. It's okay. That's great. I only found these budget letters a few years ago. My auntie said, go and read them, and it took ages. And I went to the bottling first, and you're only allowed to take in a pencil and a pad, and you have to kind of sign an oath and say, I promise I won't light a fire, and I won't destroy anything. I mean, this was in 2009 when I went for the first time. I'm not going to light a fire. Why have I got to say, I promise I will do my best and not light a fire in the bottling library? But a couple of years ago, when I went back the next time, they now let you take mobile phones in. So what I did, and thought, right, I'm going to take pictures, I'm not going to read anything, I will take pictures all day long, and then I'll take the letters back to Australia and I'll start writing them and start transcribing them. So I've only got from 1906 to about the 1920s. I've got little bits from the 1930s and 70s, but you've got all these huge gaps that I've got no idea what's happening next, only that I know the letters keep going. They went round and round the world as they discussed all these great big topics, and Vera kept saying about what I was doing with this in hockey, and you can see from the little snippets that I put in there how they all discuss what's going on. They take the mickey out of each other, and I think that's what makes stories like this so interesting, that you've in a way got all the dry facts. What match, what person, who won, who lost. It's these personal bits that bring the people to life. The fact you've got the stuff about Marjorie Pollard, the background of who they were and what happened, not just the who won and who lost and who was captain and who was the reserve. It's stuff like this that really brings it to life. And then when there's photos as well, and then you put a bit of colour in them, and it's like, wow, they look just like us. And it really brings the story together. So yeah, I'm working to try and put some of this into a book and working out what's the best way to share it. It's a really hard thing. I'll find out part two. Thank you.